I just, okay, I think
no.
This
so I
is
just,
how it, remote teaching is so first, okay.
Do I just press,
here. Okay,
I just gotta press play, right?
Gerald,
or is it,
Gerald,
do I
can
join
you hear me?
The call?
I can't.
Yes.
Okay, Gerald, hello? Gerald!
Hi.
I think I see you.
Hi, Emily.
Hi, Gerald.
Hello.
Oh my gosh, it's so good to see you.
It's good to see you too, Emily. It's been
real
rough with this social isolation.
Oh my gosh, it's been 4 weeks.
Ugh. So long. That's it's like a year in puppet years.
It's a really long time. It's a really long time. But I thought that we could still have our musical theater history lessons. What do you say?
Well, you know, I've had a lot of time to just sort of binge movies and stuff, and I've been like watching Mamma Mia over and over again. So that's kind of what I've been into right now.
Well, that is a perfect segue, Gerald, because today we are going to be talking about jukebox musicals.
Wow! I love jukebox musicals.
Hit it!
Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square.
Tell all the gang at 42nd Street that I will soon be there. Whisper of how I'm yearning to mingle with the old-time throng. Give my regards to old Broadway and say that I'll be there ere long.
In the early 1980s, Judy Kramer, a 20-something stage manager of Cats in London's West End, struck up a friendship with songwriters Benny Andersson and Björn Ulvaeus of the Swedish pop group ABBA. Having recently seen Chess, their new musical collaboration with Tim Rice, and already well aware of ABBA's global popularity, Kramer was convinced their bombastic pop catalog would translate perfectly into a stage show. It would take over a decade of convincing, but by 1997, Benny and Bjorn handed over the songs to Kramer, who commissioned playwright Katherine Johnson to put together a book. In 1998, director Phyllida Lloyd was brought on, and with Kramer's producer, Mamma Mia would open in the West End the following year. A Broadway transfer would follow in 2001, where the show would run for over 15 years, making it the 9th longest running show in Broadway history. Mamma Mia has been performed in over 40 countries, has made over $2 billion, and has been adapted into a wildly popular film version with a sequel. But most notably, Mamma Mia is Broadway's longest running jukebox musical.
Whoa, Emily, you're making me thirsty with this talk of jukebox musicals.
Nope, jukebox, Gerald, jukebox musicals.
Oh, well, what is a jukebox?
Okay, well, you know those videos Patti LuPone has been making lately of her in her basement, and she's been dancing around one of them?
Oh, the thing with the metal balls and clicky clackers?
Nope, that is a pinball machine. Oh my God, I feel so old. A jukebox is this like big box thing, and it's got a lot of lights, and it's got a bunch of songs on it, and you put in a quarter, and you press a button, and then it plays a song. That's what a jukebox is.
The jukebox musical feels like a recent phenomenon, as they have indeed had something of a renaissance in the decades following Mamma Mia, but taking the catalog of an existing artist and fashioning their work into a stage show is nothing new. In fact, it dates back to the earliest days of Broadway in one form or another. In our Origins of Broadway video, we discussed how the songwriters of Tin Pan Alley would be commissioned to write songs for Broadway musical comedies from the early 1900s. Broadway was America's most popular form of entertainment through the 1920s and remained a staple on the pop music charts all the way through the advent of rock and roll in the 1950s. Therefore, Broadway musicals were different than how we know of them today. Many of them were musical reviews with the intention of showing off the songs. No one song was connected to the show it was in, giving the composers an entire catalog of tunes that could float freely from musical to musical. But things took a change in 1943 when Oklahoma became the first musical to integrate the songs into the plot, developing what we know of as the modern book musical. However, that's not to say that those old songs from the 20s and 30s weren't still popular, and Hollywood, as it always does, took advantage of that nostalgia. In fact, you can find lots of movie musicals from the 40s and 50s that are essentially jukebox musicals. The most famous ones that we still talk about today would be Singin' in the Rain, which took the catalog of songwriters Nacio Herb Brown and Arthur Freed, and was shaped into a story by the legendary team of Betty Comden and Adolph Green. And there's also White Christmas, which adapted the songs of legendary Tin Pan Alley composer Irving Berlin into an entirely new story. Indeed, this is the allure of the jukebox musical, the familiarity, the sing-along ability, if you will. Broadway musicals don't come cheap nowadays, and producers always want some assurance that they can get an audience into those seats. It doesn't hurt when all your songs represent the catalog of a beloved pop icon, or perhaps represent an era, genre, or style. If the show is family-friendly enough, which, you know, most of them are, it's a way to introduce your kids or grandkids to a musician you loved when you were their age. My mom took all the women in our family to see Beautiful, and she clapped and sang along with tears in her eyes like I do to Britney Spears, who is also getting a jukebox musical. In fact, there are lots of different kinds of jukebox musicals, and they can range from award-winning to cringeworthy. For every Mamma Mia, there are at least five Lennons, or Good Vibrations, or Holler If You Hear Me's. So let's break down the different categories of jukebox musicals, shall we?
These are categories I've come up with myself, and keep in mind there is some nuance and bleeding between them. I mean, not every show fits into a box, a jukebox.
Oh, that reminds me, I'm all out of juice boxes. I should put that on my grocery list. I got some other things to get. I gotta get toilet paper and paper towels.
Can't be touching my face.
The bio musicals. These are arguably the most successful shows in terms of critical acclaim and good storytelling. The bio jukebox musical focuses on the life story of an artist and uses their music mostly diegetically, in that they are usually performing their songs on stage so that the other characters in the show can hear them. You know, Carole King breaks up with her husband and the musical ends with her writing Tapestry, or so I was hanging around with the Four Seasons and then Frankie starts humming a melody. You know, there could be a lot of fourth wall breaking and narration to tell a life story.
Or the show could be a snapshot of an important event, like Million Dollar Quartet, which tells the story of the famous recording session between Elvis Presley, Johnny Cash, Jerry Lee Lewis, and Carl Perkins.
The earliest example of a bio musical I've found is 1968's George M., starring Joel Grey and featuring the music of George M. Cohan, one of Broadway's earliest and biggest stars. His catalog of music featured songs that were staples of not only the musical theater community.
Give my regards to Broadway.
But of these United States of America.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave.
George M. ran for a respectable 433 performances, but the bio musical trend would continue only sporadically until the early 2000s when Mamma Mia burst on the scene. 2005 became a big year for jukebox musicals, especially when Jersey Boys, the bio musical about the Four Seasons, would earn multiple Tony Awards, including Best Musical, and run for years on Broadway. Despite the legitimacy Jersey Boys brought to the bio musical, the same year would also see the disastrous run of Lennon, featuring the music of John Lennon and Yoko Ono, running for less than 50 performances. Some mediocre biographical musicals would be successful due to the charisma of their star, like Hugh Jackman playing Peter Allen in The Boy from Oz, or Stephanie J. Block as Cher in The Cher Show. Or by the pocketbooks of producing artists. I mean, Gloria and Emilio Estefan's On Your Feet was far from a success, but they sure paid to keep it running way past its expiration date. But whether the bio musical is a hit or a flop, like the Academy Awards, there is almost always a Tony nomination for Best Actor or Actress. And in the case of Hugh Jackman, John Lloyd Young, Jesse Mueller, and Stephanie J. Block, wins. There will always be popular musicians, so there will always be new stories to tell, no matter how out there the subject may be. Both Kurt Vile and Fela Kuti have had their stories told in musical form. Heck, Janis Joplin is the subject of two different bio musicals, Love Janis and A Night with Janis Joplin. But if you really want to ensure success and tap into that boomer demographic, you gotta focus on the sounds of the 60s and 70s. Ain't Too Proud, Summer, Baby It's You, Jersey Boys, Beautiful, The Cher Show, Tina, Motown, the list goes on and on and on and on and on.
So, if I want to win a Tony Award, all I have to do is write a jukebox bio musical about an interesting musician from the 60s?
Pretty much, yeah.
Oh boy, I already have a title. Tiptoe Through the Tulips, : The Tiny Tim Musical. Tiptoe through the window, through the window, that is
terrible. Nobody is going to get that reference.
The Shoehorned Shows. This kind of jukebox musical takes the best music from an artist and tries to shoehorn the songs into a plot. Now, don't let the title fool you, though. Sometimes The Shoehorned Show works extremely well. Singing in the Rain, White Christmas, and of course Mamma Mia pull this off effortlessly. Shamelessly so when it comes to Mamma Mia. In fact, sometimes the more shameless and meta, the better. 2009's Rock of Ages is a beloved jukebox musical, but no one would categorize it as high art. Another benefit Ages has is that it doesn't focus on a singular artist, but a genre of music, 80s hair metal rock, an extremely theatrical and beloved musical style that translates well to the stage, all while capturing an era. The Shoehorned Show can be the biggest dumpster fire when it doesn't work, though, and the jukebox musical landscape is littered with the corpses of these flops, especially in the early 2000s. There's All Shook Up, Good Vibrations, Ring of Fire, I know. Elvis Presley, Beach Boys, Johnny Cash musicals all flopped, and it's not because their music isn't accessible or theatrical, it's that the shoehorned plot just didn't work. And then there are shows like Escape to Margaritaville, Holler If You Hear Me, and The Times They Are a-Changin', which, like, I'm sorry, but how do you make Jimmy Buffett, Tupac Shakur, and Bob Dylan's songs work in a breezy Broadway musical? I don't know, but Bob Dylan is getting a second chance in it this year with The Girl from the North Country. But going back to Shameless, it's always intriguing to see how the writers will find excuses to make certain titles work in these shows. For example, in American Idiot, there has to be characters named What's Her Name and Saint Jimmy, or with Jagged Little Pill, there needs to be a major romantic breakup to justify the appearance of You Oughta Know. Or my favorite lazy transition. In Bat Out of Hell, they have one character leave his love interest 3/4 of the way through Act 2, only to immediately flash 6 months later on the stage, have him dramatically return so they can sing, It's All Coming Back to Me Now.
You've been gone for so long. There were nights when the wind was cold.
Speaking of Bat Out of Hell, it seems that the British have a much higher appreciation for the jukebox musical in all its forms. We mentioned that Mamma Mia was born on the West End, but there are plenty of jukebox musicals that have never made a Broadway transfer, like Jim Steinman's Bat Out of Hell, Take That's the Band, and Queen's We Will Rock You. The bio-musical Buddy, the Buddy Holly story, ran for only a year or so on Broadway in 1990, but lasted for 12 years on the West End. In the end, it's no coincidence that the most successful shoehorn musicals have songs that translate well to the stage. Not every pop song is inherently theatrical, but the catalogs of The Go-Go's, Alanis Morissette, and The Gershwins have ensured that Head Over Heels, Jagged Little Pill, and both Crazy for You and Nice Work If You Can Get It have become successful and beloved jukebox musicals. Movie to jukebox musical. Before we move on, there is one little niche spin-off category we need to touch on. The movie to jukebox musical. This is when a stage show is directly inspired by the movie version that came first. So they tell the same story, feature the same characters, and usually the majority of the score is pre-existing music connected to that film. Some of these were jukebox movie musicals to begin with, like The Who's Tommy, Xanadu, and Moulin Rouge. But just like every movie is being made into a musical these days, jukebox shows are not exempt. Priscilla, Queen of the Desert pulled this off with some success, which makes sense since the show was already about the theatricality of drag queens and had an iconic score of disco classics. Saturday Night Fever, on the other hand, fizzled when the music of the Bee Gees was brought to life on stage. In the case of all these, though, we get a shoehorned plot to fit around a jukebox score, so it's worth mentioning. The Musical Review. Musical reviews date back to the earliest days of Broadway, as that would best describe what musicals were until shows like Showboat in Oklahoma came around. They were just a bunch of songs and acts connected by a theme, or sometimes not even that. Reviews were a way to showcase vaudeville stars or the latest Irving Berlin hit, and they were never meant to have a story. And the review lives on in the Jukebox Musical, as some smartly forego any semblance of a plot, making the event simply a showcase for the music. They can have a fourth wall breaking cabaret style like Ain't Misbehavin' in 1978 or Smokey Joe's Cafe in 1995, or there can be the flimsiest framing device, usually involving the actors performing the songs diegetically for us, the audience. Forever Plaid and the Marvelous Wonderettes both pull this off successfully with songs from 50s and 60s girl and guy groups. With The Curious Case of Movin' Out, we have the rare instance of a musical in which the Billy Joel songs are all performed by a band on stage while the dancers act out a story choreographed by Twyla Tharp. Finally, the musical review is the ideal way to demonstrate the greatest hits of a Broadway artist. Both Bob Fosse and Jerome Robbins received two wildly successful Broadway reviews, and Stephen Sondheim has no less than four, both on and off Broadway. One of them, Marry Me a Little, only featured Sondheim's cut songs from other shows. Considering the Broadway history and pedigree and practicality behind it, the musical review is likely to be a staple of Broadway for years to come.
Think about it, Gerald. Nonstop. The musicals of Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Waving Through a Window. Passick and Paul on Broadway.
Oh, or The Electricity of Elton John on Broadway. Wait a second. Elton John should absolutely have a musical review by now. He's written at least four Broadway shows.
Hold on. I saw Elton John's Jukebox movie musical Rocket Man. You mean to tell me he's written new musicals too?
Exactly. And that leads us to our conversation about popsicles.
Okay, now I know I'm not hearing that wrong. Did you say you want a popsicle?
Oh, that would be nice, but no. It's just a funny name I came up with for when an established musician writes a new score for a Broadway show. Oh. So pop star writing a musical, you get popsicle.
I want a popsicle.
Popsicles. Every once in a while, some well-known musician gets it in their head that, because they write songs that play on the radio, they can just as easily write an entire Broadway score. This is when the popsicle occurs. It doesn't matter how good or bad the show is. If your name is big enough, you'll get enough producers to give you at worst an out-of-town tryout and at best, a Broadway run. Sir Elton John is probably the most prolific and successful of the popsicle writers. John first dipped his toe in the Broadway pool when The Lion King came to Broadway in 1997 and broke box office records. He followed this up with 2000's hit Aida, the 2006 flop Lestat, and the 2008 award-winning Billy Elliot. Elton John is obviously a fantastic pop songwriter, but more importantly, he understands how a Broadway book musical is structured. In fact, this is what makes his movie musical Rocket Man one of the few jukebox bio musicals that breaks formula by placing the songs where they make sense for the emotional narrative, not necessarily in the order in which he wrote them. Putting aside the idea that many Broadway songwriters had pop success all the way through the 1950s, we can see one of the first examples of the modern popsicle in 1968 with the musical Promises, Promises by famous songwriter Burt Bacharach. Considering Bacharach's talent for writing hits, it's no surprise that Promises, Promises churned out some of its own. You know, like I say a little prayer for you. From then on, musicians outside the world of Broadway would take on scoring a show to varying degrees of success. Tim Minchin would soar with Matilda, yet falter with Groundhog Day. Rupert Holmes, you know, if you like pina coladas, that guy. He wrote Edwin Drood, then took a 20-year break and came back with Curtains. I gotta say, it is fascinating to see which shows are written in the pop star's signature voice and which are able to stand on their own. With the exception of Rocket Man, no one in Elton John musicals really sings like Elton John. Maybe Adam Pascal, maybe. And while Sarah Bareilles does have a firm grasp on writing and scoring, being a former musical theater girl herself, I can't escape how Waitress's Jesse Mueller's voice is a dead ringer for Bareilles. And there were a myriad of problems with the infamous Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, but one of the weirdest choices is how Reeve Carney managed to sing exactly like Bono, or how Megan Hilty was meant to directly imitate Dolly Parton's iconic twang in 9 to 5. But again, this is a category in which the duds outweigh the hits. Steve Martin and Edie Brickell's Bright Star rocked a fun, folky score, but a flimsy and lackluster book. The Last Ship was a blast to listen to when Sting was previewing songs in concert, but completely tanked on Broadway. Why? It's always the book, people! It's the book!
Harry Connick Jr.'s Thou Shalt Not and Boy George's biopopsicle Taboo both failed to connect with audiences, and nobody really cared about Bryan Adams' take on Pretty Woman.
A Broadway score is not an album, even though sometimes musicals do start out that way. The concept album is nothing new to musical theater. Andrew Lloyd Webber's musicals from the 70s all started out as pop concept albums before they were brought to the stage. And jukebox musicals like Tommy and American Idiot were both derived from albums that came first. There's also Chess, written by our pals Benny and Bjorn from ABBA, Faust by Randy Newman, and even Hadestown started out as original songs on a concept album. In fact, Hadestown is an interesting case study, as Anais Mitchell was quite the underground artist, but she still managed to nab Annie DeFranco and the lead singer of Bon Iver to contribute vocals, surely adding to the album's success and eventual stage iterations. In my opinion, some of the best popsicles come from lesser-known artists like Anais Mitchell, because these are usually the shows that are actually good and not coasting on star power.
So there was Big River by country songwriter Roger Miller. You know, I'm a man of means by no means, king of the road. Or, Spring Awakenings by Duncan Sheik, the I'm barely breathing another day, that guy. And then, Memphis was by David Bryan. He was the keyboardist for Bon Jovi.
You give love a band-aid.
But on the other hand, there are some pop stars who seem destined to write a new musical and be great at it. When 80s icon Cyndi Lauper teamed up with gay icon Harvey Fierstein, we got Kinky Boots. David Byrne and Fatboy Slim combined their powers off-Broadway to bring us Here Lies Love. And no less than 15 different pop stars wrote the SpongeBob SquarePants score, including Lauper and Bareilles and They Might Be Giants, who, dear God, why is there no jukebox musical for They Might Be Giants? Anyway, jukebox musicals and popsicles have been long-standing traditions in musical theater and are likely to remain so as long as nostalgia and celebrity worship are still a thing. And I, a notorious musical theater snob, will absolutely fall victim to both when the Britney Spears jukebox musical comes to Broadway. And damn you, coronavirus, for delaying Once Upon a One More Time, baby.
Okay, Gerald, and all you students out there, your homework has two parts to it. Okay. Number one, you got to look in the description below at the list of jukebox musicals and popsicles, or maybe hunt on your own, and give them a listen, and give them a watch even. I bet a lot of clips of these shows are on YouTube. Yeah. And number two, you have to write in the comments below and tell us who you think deserves to have a jukebox musical of their music. I would have said Huey Lewis in the News, but they got a show a couple years ago. So what about you, Gerald?
Oh, Weird Al Yankovic. Let's see how they shoehorn a plot around all those parodies and polkas. parodies and polkas. That could be the title.
Expand your musical theater knowledge and it'll make you a better musical theater lover, I promise. Until next time, Broadway babies. Mamma mia, here I go again.
My, how could I resist ya?